Hello, everyone. So what the freaky alien baby didn't say in the video introduction was that the next Einstein Forum thing I got nominated for because I had the hair most similar to Einstein. Okay, so you heard a little bit about what I'm going to talk about today, but I'd like to start with a story. This is the cue for a story. So, a long, long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, just south of planet X31, I was working as a doctor in an HIV clinic. I was doing my PhD at the time in looking at HIV-TB, obviously two of the most important conditions, trying to understand how they interact. And I was seeing patients who were on treatment with antiretroviral therapy, which is the treatment for ARVs. So this was after the rollout of ARVs, so essentially HIV was becoming and is becoming a chronic disease. So I saw patients day in and day out. Day in and day out. They were actually relatively healthy. On medication, it's a chronic condition. You can live a full life. So one day, one thing happened that made me pause. So one of my regular patients, let's call her Faith, about 40, relatively young, I will say for selfish reasons, didn't miss her appointment with me, which is very unlike her. So when I eventually saw her again, I said, well, why did you miss your appointment? She says, oh, I'm really sorry, I had another appointment. I thought, what could be more important than this appointment? And she says, no, I'm also in treatment for high blood pressure, for hypertension, and had my 6-monthly appointment. And she kept talking, but I stopped listening at that point because I was thinking, how do I not know that this person who I've seen month in and month out for over essentially years, how did I not know she was on treatment for another chronic disease? And then looking at her, obviously I didn't suspect it because she was quite young. But then working through her risk factors, I started realizing, well, it's kind of obvious. How did I miss it? And so first thing I thought was, how common is this? Because our health system is set up so that we see if you have HIV, you go over here on Mondays. If you have hypertension, you go over there on Tuesdays. Don't have both because, you know, you have one. So it got me thinking, well, how much of this is there? How much coexistence is there between these diseases that are not thought to coexist? Okay, out of the story now. So, just to give a bit of background on the state of health in South Africa, we normally refer to the burden of disease as a quadruple burden of disease in South Africa. Oh, excellent. Thank you. This is one of them, by the way. So we have HIV-TB. This class is one together because they actually often coexist. So we know that HIV is the strongest known risk factor for TB. And in South Africa, over 2/3 of TB patients are co-infected with HIV. So that's one. The second in the quadruple is non-communicable diseases, which are essentially diseases that are not non-infectious. So those are the diabetes, the hypertension, the cancers. The third is a very heterogeneous group that I've shortened to MCH, maternal child health, but it includes largely infectious diseases that affect children around the time of birth, affect mothers around pre and peri and post-pregnancy, also relates to nutritional deficiencies. And the fourth is injuries and violence. So that in South Africa is a quadruple burden of disease. That is essentially what is responsible for pretty much all of our burden of disease. So what is interesting, I want to introduce the concept of epidemiological transition before we move on. So this was proposed in the 70s by an epidemiologist who noticed that a lot of societies moved from, if you study the patterns of population health, they moved from, you know, these intense periods of famine and pestilence, pandemics, or a lot of infectious diseases. And as they start to develop and as they start to industrialize, if you like, those infectious diseases start declining and you get this rise in these non-communicable chronic degenerative conditions. So that is the kind of marker of a society developing. That's been what is known as classical epidemiological transition. But the reality that we see in countries like South Africa, and in fact many other low and middle income countries, is one of a protracted transition. In other words, we don't have this decline in infectious diseases and rise in non-communicable diseases. What we're actually seeing is this rise in non-communicable diseases occurring alongside persistent infectious diseases. And this is largely being changed by HIV, because infections are normally considered acute, but HIV is essentially a chronic disease, at the moment incurable. So what we're seeing is a lot of these infectious diseases just persisting. We're not getting rid of them. At the same time, I'm seeing this rise in non-communicable diseases. So don't try and read anything. I want to focus on colors, okay? This is recent, this is actually just hot off the press, as hot of the press as academic journals get, because you see it's 2012 as the latest data. If you look at the colors, the red is HIV TB, the blue is, bless you, non-communicable diseases, the green is injuries, and the purple is that motley crew of maternal child issues. So if you look at the colors, moving from 97 to 2000, 2005 to 2012. If we start with the red first, so we have this blip of red at 0 to someone over here has got hair like mine, 0 to in the early under ones, and then we see this curve, so this peak starting in 97, in the young, so in the 22 to 45 age group. We see as we proceed through time, this red really starting to spike. Up just after this, we introduced, after the denialist period, we introduced antiretroviral therapy rollout across the country, and we see this sharp decline. So you can still, the shape stays the same because it affects the same population age group. You see the sharp decline. You also see a sharp decline in mother-to-child transmission of HIV, and that is largely to do with antiretroviral therapy. In fact, it's entirely to do with antiretroviral therapy. When we look at the blue, before the red, actually, we see that it's still persistent. So it's gone right down from the peak of the epidemic, but it's very much still persistent, right? Look at the blue. If you look at the shape of the blue, so 97, you have this funnel, right, this way. You have the funnel this way as you get younger, right? Which means that really you have this huge increase in the burden, in how much non-communicable disease you have as you get older, which is what you expect to see. But look at the shape. And look at the... If you look through the years, you see that we start to lose a little bit of that neck of that funnel. In other words, the neck starts widening a little bit. And that tells us that we're seeing much more of these conditions at earlier ages. Okay? Remember, this is talking about mortality. So this is death. So it's not just a disease that kills older, but actually we're seeing it creep into the younger in population. This is some of the transition I'm talking about. If we look at the burden of disease, so there's two ways you can measure disease. We often get caught up in mortality, so the cause of death, because that's striking, you know. But with a lot of chronic diseases, it's important to get a better sense of the burden, because there's some diseases that don't have a high mortality, but actually you live life, a lot of life, with disability, and your quality of life is much more reduced. So if you don't measure the burden of disease, you don't have a sense of how important and how much these diseases contribute to ill health in your population. We use something called the disability-adjusted life years, and that essentially takes premature, the number of years of life that you lose due to the disease, and the number of years of life you live with disability. So your number of years of life not in full health. And just to quantify the burden, how much these diseases contribute to population health. I put all the some low middle income regions, but I just want to focus on Southern Africa, because a lot of the data from the Southern Africa burden of disease report was driven by South Africa. And what do we see here? So remembering this is burden of disease. So we are seeing the HIV top. We are seeing the tuberculosis high up there. But in the top 10, we're also seeing the diabetes. Those major depressive disorders. These are not things that if you look at mortality, you miss, right? Because HIV untreated has got a high mortality. Depressive disorders untreated does not have as much high mortality, and you might be mistaken to think that it's not contributing to ill health in the country. So again, this is demonstrating this transition, because you're seeing a mix really in the top 15 of infectious, some acute, some chronic, and non-infectious, non-communicable diseases. So normally when people refer to chronic diseases, they actually refer to non-infectious and non-communicable diseases. You'll hear me refer to HIV, hope that's not coming for us, as a chronic disease, because it really is, it's an infectious disease, but it's a chronic disease, and it's important that we treat it accordingly. Again, colors. So this is morbidity. This is burden of disease, which is what I just described, the disability-adjusted life years, or DALYs there. And this is to give you a snapshot of how this burden of disease has changed over time. So this is between 1990 and 2010. And what do you see? So all the bars up are increase, all the bars below are decreases. And it tells you how much they've increased or decreased. The red is infectious diseases. The blue is non-communicable diseases. The green relates to injury and violence. I see HIV has been put there as well. So what do we see between 1990 and 2010? Huge increase in morbidity. We're talking morbidity, not death. In HIV, we see a bit of decrease in diarrheal diseases, respiratory infections, preterm birth complications. But the first thing you see, the first striking thing in this diagram, is that most of the bars are up. Okay. The second striking thing is that there's a hell of a lot more blue up than red, but we have both red and blue. Importantly, violence and injury, something that's often forgotten, road injury, interpersonal violence. So a lot of these are on the up. But this, again, is just demonstrating this pattern of transition where we're not quite getting rid of infectious diseases, largely driven by the HIV, but we're seeing this rise in non-communicable diseases. This was actually in today's, I saw this on the way here and I thought, let's take a snapshot. In today's Cape Times, so have a look at it if you get a chance. Otherwise, it was in The Conversation, which is an online piece you should all be signed up to. And it really was just describing exactly this, that whilst we hear a lot about HIV and TB, and it's still, particularly TB, we're still not getting on top of it for something that is entirely curable. we mustn't forget that these diseases, cancer, diabetes, cardio, they're really starting on the rise. And because the mortality is delayed, we're not getting the shock images we saw when we weren't adequately treating HIV. So now we know that the diseases are co-occurring. But I'm sure you, like me, before I was sat there with Faith, thought, well, yes, so maybe they are co-occurring, but infectious diseases tend to be more common, more prevalent in the lower the socioeconomic status, and these chronic diseases of lifestyle, and hopefully by the time you leave here, you won't use the word lifestyle again, and I'll tell you why, are more kind of in the richer population. So yes, it's happening in one country, but surely they're happening in just different people, right? No, it turns out. So we actually conducted a study. After I saw Faith, I thought, I just want to get a sense of how common this is, that patients with HIV, on treatment for HIV, are on treatment for other chronic conditions. So we got we identified one clinic, one government clinic, and we looked over a nine-month period at everybody who turned up in that nine-month period. And then we looked at their records to see who was on treatment for one of the four most common, so HIV, TB, diabetes, and hypertension, as these chronic diseases. I lumped TB as a chronic disease partly because the treatment is protracted, and so some of the issues with staying on treatment, they share in common with chronic diseases. So we looked for people on treatment for one of these four conditions. It was just under half of patients that were seen in the clinic over a nine-month period came for one of those four. Almost half. So that was about 15,000 people. We then looked at, okay, so we know you attended and you're on treatment. We didn't diagnose, it's just people on treatment already. We know you're on treatment for one of these four. How many people are on treatment for something else? Just to try and get a sense of how much they're overlapping. Because if they're overlapping a lot, we need to do something in our health system. Because in our health system, we're treating people as if they have one, right? What did we find? I want you to focus on this, because this was the HIV. So this is patients on antiretroviral therapy. So amongst all the people who were on treatment for ARVs, antiretroviral therapy, almost one in five were on treatment for another chronic disease. So immediately I realized, okay, turns out Faith isn't really that rare. Now, if there are any clinicians or medical people in the room, if you say someone on HIV is on treatment for another disease, because we're so cued to thinking about TB, HIV, we think, oh yeah, it's probably TB because they're so tied together. But in actual fact, over three quarters of that was hypertension. So I thought, okay, I've been missing a trick here. Actually, this is much more prevalent than I realized. So then I started thinking, trying to work through what I know about the transition and trying to think through, well, what are the drivers? What is causing this changing pattern of disease? It doesn't just happen. What are the risk factors that that people are exposed to that is causing this changing pattern of disease to occur within the same same population? Because it felt to me like I was, you know, seeing patients day after day, day in, day out, day in, day out, day in, day out, with the same thing. It felt a little bit like, and if you picture me as a good swimmer, at a riverside, okay? Picture me at the riverside, sitting out, looking out the river, seeing somebody drowning, swimming out, pulling them out, resuscitating them, bringing them back to life, and go, oh, fantastic, I did my job. And just as I'm catching my breath, I look up again, I see another, I swim out, I pull them up, I resuscitate them, I swim out again, I pull them, and I felt actually like I was, that's kind of what it felt like I was doing day in, day out, seeing the same people trying to improve their health by making sure they're on treatment, making sure they're staying on treatment, screening them for TB, and it felt like I was so busy doing that. I didn't really get a chance to pause, realize I was actually on the foot of a cliff, realizing that not only were people falling off the cliff and into the river, but that there was someone pushing them in the first place. Now you think, well, surely it makes sense. Yes, they need to be rescued because you can't leave people to drown. But it makes sense in the long term to say, hang on, who is that pushing them in? And can we figure out, firstly, who put the cliff there, who's pushing them in, and how we can get rid of them? So then I started thinking, so that push, those drivers of disease, and that's what we term in public health, the upstream determinants of disease, or social determinants of disease. And this is something that is the holy grail, if you like, of social determinants of disease. And what it essentially shows is that in thinking about the causes of disease, we often focus here, right in the middle, right? We focus on the age, as you get older, what men versus women have access, are at risk of, hereditary factors, your genetics, right? We also then maybe go up here and focus on these lifestyle factors. Now, I'll tell you why I don't... I have a problem with that word lifestyle, but I'll come back to that. If I forget, remind me. So we often focus on that, what you must do, your behaviors, your apart from your in the risk factors you came with, how you act, what you eat, what you do. Those are the factors that we think about when we think about what determines disease. But actually, if we go up a bit, go up the cliff, we look at the social and the community. Go up even more. Look at the living, the conditions that you are born, the conditions that you live, the conditions that you play, the conditions that you work, conditions that you age. Those conditions are really vital in determining your burden, your risk of disease, and your determinants of disease. So I started thinking about this, back to the story. So, and a sip. Just think about what I said for a moment. So I started thinking about faith, right? So I started thinking about, now I know that the conditions that she presented with to me were not actually uncommon, which is what I thought they were, as I showed before. And I started thinking about these upstream determinants. And I started wondering, what are her exposures? What are the factors that she's exposed to in this diagram here? What are the determinants of her disease? Now, because we're doing this in a city, I started kind of getting a sense of, well, what are the factors? I felt like I was sitting just within the clinic, waiting for her to come in, just ignoring what was outside of the clinic walls. Whereas actually what was outside of the clinic walls, what was determining her risk of disease in the first place. So I started thinking about her environment and the city that she came from. And not just thinking about the city. So we think about a city, right? But how do you, if you're trying to think about the city as a determinant, how do you start to do that? How do you start to quantify exposure to a city? How do you say you're 25% city exposed? What does that mean? And what aspects of the city, right? So when you say city, so this is some pictures from Johannesburg, right? So this is some of the images that are conjured when you think about the city, right? Big tall buildings, lots of cars, lots of those taxis that we love. But thinking as the epidemiologist, start thinking about them as an exposure. So when epidemiologists think, and I know there's at least one other one in the room, we think about the outcome, which is the disease. But we go back and think about the exposure, and we try to link what exposures are causing what outcomes. So if you think, everybody knows epidemiology is best in outbreak investigations. So, you know, you have an outbreak, you go in, there's this outcome, you're trying to work out what the exposure is to try and work out what is driving the epidemic. So it's the same. So I'm thinking about, how is this an exposure? And how does this impact on her health status? So thinking about this a little bit more, I started thinking about, well, what are the common risk factors that we know occur here? Again, colors. So this figure essentially shows the proportion of the burden of disease, this DALYS, the disability-adjusted life years I told you about earlier, the proportion of the DALYS that each of these risk factors contribute to. So as promised, you see, alcohol is a really... So this is in... this is South Africa. Is a significant contributor to the burden of disease. Just walk you through the colors. This... see how they're coming out. I'm always told my colors are a bit off. So let's start with green, what's obviously green, right? There. So that is, let me try and remember now. Okay, I'll come back to it. The blue, this here, are the cardiovascular, so the heart sort of diseases. The green, I think, was... diabetes, thank you. So the green was diabetes and endocrine, so hormonal disorders. Here, basically the spectrum of pinks up by the alcohol here are all injury related, right? The yellow, the most leftmost color above, is HIV and TB. So what you start to see, what I like about this graph is, normally we think very singularly. We think high blood pressure, heart disease, sugar, diabetes. But actually when you look on this side, if we just look above that line, so you look at, this is high sugar. Yes, this is diabetes. This is heart disease, and this is, it's HIV, but it's TB. Because believe it or not, diabetes increases your risk of TB threefold. So it's a lot more complex than sugar. We should worry about just diabetes. If you look at smoking, it's a combination of heart disease, it's cancers, it's TB again, a threefold increase. Again, we think smoking, cancer, but actually in our setting, significant contributor to the TB burden. Dietary risk factors, we have cancers, we have heart disease, we have diabetes. Blood pressure, we have heart disease and diabetes. High body mass index, so that's overweight and obesity. We have the cancers, we have the diabetes, etc. So what you start to see and started thinking through are the common risk factors and the kind of spectrum of diseases they cause. What do you start to see here, Will? The quadruple burden is kind of all in there, right? There's a lot of overlap in terms of the risk factors, one. Two, a lot of those risk factors are more common, you're more often exposed to them in urban versus rural. So I started thinking, okay, maybe we can start thinking about distilling and quantifying that city exposure, thinking about these common risk factors. Are you with me so far? Excellent. So, I quantified the urban exposure into what I call, since yesterday, the seven S's of urban exposure. It stuck with me. I hope it sticks with you. I can work out if it goes 7 or 10, you see. But 7 is a good number, right? Seven S's of urban exposure. What are these? sugar and salt, and that relates to more broadly to the food-related, dietary-related issues. It wasn't an S, so I didn't add it there, but also food insecurity relates to, very tied into sugar and salt. So the less access you have to food, the more likely you are to access more processed food that are high in both sugar and salt. Okay. Smoke and smoking, lump them together because in an urban environment, you actually higher uptake of smoking, especially in the younger age group, but also the smoke in terms of air pollution, which is often, you know, is what you probably came in here expecting me to say. Third is sleep and stress. Put them together because anyone who's been sleep deprived knows that they go hand in hand. But also the stress related to living in a city, even if you sleep. It also relates to noise pollution, which is not one of the pollutions we think about. We think air, we think water, but noise significantly impacts. Now, what I'll do is I'll walk you through, go through them now, but I'll walk you through some of the ways that they cause some of the quadruple burden of disease. Sports and recreation, so this speaks to your physical area around you, your access to exercise, your mobility, your choices of transport, etc. Sanitation and water often go hand in hand, fairly self-explanatory. Safe housing and social cohesion. I put these together because often when we think about housing, we think about the physical structure. But actually, housing is much more than the physical structure. The World Health Organization actually has these dimensions of housing referred to. So it's not just a physical structure, but it's the conditions of the home. So this is the psychological, the social, the economic conditions of the home. The neighborhood, in terms of the infrastructure and the access and the community, and that ties in very closely with social cohesion and the infrastructure in the area around the neighborhood and around the home. So when we think about housing, please don't think just of the house. It's not just about putting a house down. And largely sex. Okay? So I put this there because we still know that HIV is the number one
cause of mortality, of cause of death in South Africa. But we also know, thinking about, well, what's that got to do with the urban? You're thinking, I live in the city, but you know. It's that we found from some of our research that particularly if you are in a low socioeconomic state, your vulnerability to acquisition of HIV is much higher as a new migrant into the city. So whilst sex relieves some of that stress, it sometimes causes it. Okay, so I'll link them to those quadruple burden disease. But before I do, now this is a bit where you give you some framing concepts, and this is a bit where you think. So I'm going to give you two framing concepts just to guide you through as I'm pulling through how those seven S's relate to the quadruple burden, to think about these two concepts. The first is equity. And I really want to drive home, firstly, speaking about the difference between equality and equity. It might sound like semantics, but if we're thinking about providing stalls to look over this fence, equality is everybody gets the same stall. Because it's fair, right? Everyone gets the same. But it doesn't achieve the effect that you think it will achieve. Equity is that the short ass like me gets it's been recorded, I forgot what to say. the vertically challenged person gets a bit more of a store in order to achieve the same effect. This is equity.
different from equality. And the reason I'm highlighting that is, as we think about these seven S's and as we think about how they contribute to the quadruple burden, I'd like us to reflect a little bit on the differential exposure, i.e. living in the same city. There is inequity in what seven S's we're exposed to and how, and the quality of the S, and vulnerability. So given a particular exposure, we all have different vulnerabilities to that exposure, for that exposure to cause disease. Does that make sense? So when we're thinking about when we're thinking about the seven S's, the city is not one. City residents are not one homogeneous group, because in reality, city residents have this differential exposure and have differential vulnerability. And what that results in, unsurprisingly, is different outcomes. The second concept that I want to frame the next few slides with is this concept of the life course. Now, what this essentially says is that often when we're thinking about the... when we think about exposure, we're often thinking about my exposure at this particular time, in one space and time, right? So whether it's smoke and air pollution, how is this affecting my health? What we often less think about is, how is the smoke I was exposed to as a kid affecting my health now? Or how is the sugar and salt I'm exposed to now and what it does to my health affecting the health of my offspring? So this is the concept of life course, which is that some exposures are not seen in your, don't necessarily manifest as your health. So say, for example, the health of, let's say this is a woman of reproductive age who might have, say, diabetes or might, and let's say stress, one of the answers. So stress results in, increases your risk of small for age babies, so giving birth to a baby that's small, also increases your risk of preterm deliveries, of having a premature birth. The result of a low birth weight during childhood or when you're born increases your risk of recurrent infections, because obviously as your immunity is a little bit less developed, these can increase your recurrent infections in childhood, can increase your risk of stunting, which is short for age. Which might just seem like a height thing, but stunting in childhood increases your risk of obesity and diabetes in adulthood. So when we're seeing these patients here as adolescents who are a little bit overweight or as adults who have diabetes, we're thinking now. But it's a combination of now and then. And when we're giving advice about this one here, we're giving advice for now, but we're also thinking about the health of the offspring. We're also thinking about your health as you age.
So this cycle, you can start to see how, without addressing these upstream determinants, these cycles can end up perpetuating from generation to generation. And really is why, okay, we need some swimmers, but we also need some climbers up the cliff, right? So back to my seven S's. So first, sugar and salt. We know that these, so high sugar, you've seen a little bit of that risk factor, increases your risk of diabetes and obesity. High salt increases your risk of high blood pressure and obesity. We know this is associated with heart disease cerebrovascular disease is actually what we're seeing in South Africa. One of the top causes of death of an HIV is cerebrovascular disease, and that is driven by the high blood pressure. South Africa has one of the highest prevalence of high blood pressure amongst over 50s. Let's have a guessing game. What proportion of over 50s in South Africa have high blood pressure? Shout a number. 40. We've got 40. Higher or lower? Higher. What's another number? 52. Higher or lower? Higher. Pessimistic crowd. Not a super pessimistic crowd. Almost 80% of over 50s have high blood pressure. High blood pressure is not just about blood pressure, right? So this is a significant contributor to the burden of disease. So when we start thinking about these urban exposures, you start to understand the gravity and why it's important to address it, not just at an individual scale, but at a population scale. Briefly, just behind the drums here, equity. So I mentioned a little bit for sugar and salt. Just reflect on the differential exposure to a negative sugar and salt environment. Reflect on what impact that has across the life course. Smoke and smoking. This one's got a long list. So smoking, we're a little bit more fair with. I just mentioned about TB, but also cancers. We often forget increased risk of recurrent infections, lung infections. We often forget the heart disease, cardiovascular disease associated with smoking. Smoke, I don't just mean outdoors, because outdoor pollution, but also indoor pollution. And this is something really to reflect on in terms of differential exposure. If you look at that picture, you can already start to see the life course. It's a woman cooking, indoors, pollution. Who's that on her back? Not breathing from a different space, right? It's breathing the same air. Sleep and stress. Interestingly, have exactly the same profile as sports and recreation. So next time you can't sleep, go for a run. Heart disease, high blood pressure, mental health. I showed earlier the burden of disease and morbidity just to stress that mental health is so important. Because people are not dropping dead from mental health problems, it's one of the most neglected diseases, but actually contributes significantly to our burden of disease, to our quality of life. Sanitation and water, largely driven by the infectious diseases, so the diseases of the newborn. I've already mentioned about thinking about now the life course approach, thinking about the risk of recurrent infections, whether they be diarrhea or pneumonias, which is so the top cause of under 5 death in South Africa is pneumonia, even though we have a vaccine for the most common pneumonia. That tells you that the environment is still important. We can't throw just a vaccine at it. It's not going to go away. Okay? Having those recurrent lung infections increases your risk in adulthood of chronic lung disease, as if you were a smoker. So if that person now as an adult then smokes, you start to understand it really is more than just looking in one time frame. Safe housing and social cohesion. Again, differential exposure and chronic respiratory disease, things like mold, things like the indoor pollution I mentioned, mental health significantly tied to a sense of self, tied to a sense of community. And sex, a bit like alcohol, is linked to pretty much everything. So, another story break. So, I started thinking now, with faith. Now I've got a sense of the kind of questions, so I'm thinking, okay, risk factors, I'm thinking the seven S's. How do I start to, I'm starting to think about how to quantify her exposure, right? But I'm also starting to realize that, as I mentioned with the equity, I may live in the same city as Faith, but we actually have these different, totally different exposures to the seven S's. Essentially, we're living in two different cities, as far as our bodies are concerned. So I think about, so when I ask her about, well, what are your common sources of food? What kind of foods do you eat regularly? It's about what she can eat quickly, can put together quickly, because her time is, she has a lot less control over her time as I do. Her food environment is a lot less accessible, so that's not just geographic accessibility, but also availability, also affordability. I think about her smoke and smoking, entirely different exposures. Sleep and stress, I don't live next to a freeway. I might think I'm stressed, because we all like a good whinge. But it's a totally different city, right? Sports and recreation, she likes to go for walks. This is where she walks. This is my sweaty self just this weekend. I'm not sure if I would do that if I had to spend an hour on the train to get there. I don't live right there, but, you know, it's close enough. Sanitation and water, entirely different cities we're living in. Safe housing, social cohesion, entirely different. We can see the same mountain. Totally different housing, totally different social cohesion. Sex, well, that's too much information, I guess. So, going back to the start of the talk, you start to realize that I ask, our city's making us sick, because I was thinking about how to go upstream, up that cliff, right? Intervening there, and not just at the river. But I'd like to change that from thinking about whether cities are making us sick to thinking about whether our cities can make us healthier. Because in thinking about how we intervene, it's important we think about what we're trying to do. We're not trying to get less sick. We're trying to get healthy, right? And the reason it's important to make that distinction is that health is more than just the absence of disease. You can take, and I realize that's partly what I was doing with Faith and my other patients, right? You're seeing patients, you're trying to take the disease away. But we could take all the disease away, we're not necessarily left with health. Because health is more about a complete state of physical, of psychological, of social well-being, not just the absence of disease. So when we start thinking about how to be healthier, it's a huge, it's a different shift from thinking about whether or not we're sick and how to get rid of the sickness. So why health? We've been talking about the city and a lot of talk about the city as if the city is this living being. In reality, the city doesn't exist without you and me, right? The city's most important asset are its people. If you took all the people out, it would essentially be like, you know, Disneyland, and you just go see the tall buildings and things. It's the people that make the city. And it's not just people occupying the city. It's people participating in the city. You need health for that. Whether it is around the health services, which is what we often think about when we think about healthcare, whether it relates to education, whether it relates to social environments, these are all the These are all the things that what we often see, the red light that we often see is ill health. Yes, viruses and bacteria cause ill health. But below that lies so much more exposure that drive the iceberg on top. Also, health is a unifying thing. I don't think anyone can disagree health is important. I mean, there's a reason when everything goes to the proverbial, we say that annoying, at least you still have your health. I said it this evening over dinner. Right? Why is that? Because when you strip everything else away, health is what? It unifies us all. Right? So this left me very confused because I'm a physician and health is what I do. So I'm like, well, I'm saying that if I need to improve faith and my other patients' health and stop thinking about it as health, but really go upstream and look at what the drivers in the city are that are causing the ill health. So I was going to have to step out of the comfort of the clinic and start conversations with people who speak a different language to me, because you know how we love our acronyms. And no one understands my acronyms, even at home. And just trying to have these conversations across people in non-health sectors who don't consider themselves as health professionals, right? Whether that be housing, whether that be transport, whether that be urban planning. And trying to have a conversation about how we can create health. This is not about how we can care for disease. I realize, by the way, that when we talk about health care, we're actually talking about disease care. Health care has almost nothing to do with the health services. That's the health services are right at the bottom of the river. They deal with the disease care. So actually, health care should be much more than health. So I started looking at the broader urban policies and how we can create health in these contexts. But as I started talking to people outside of health, I got a sense, you know, nobody disagreed. As I said, health, yes, we all agree, health is important. But I'm kind of busy. I've got a bottom line. I've got to make it work. I work in housing. I've got to deliver houses. This is all great. But I've got a lot more houses to deliver. And now even more because I've been talking to you. But I got thinking, well, what if that's not the true cost of housing? Because the reality is those seven S's we don't see in the health sector. Yet the exposures and the results of those exposures we see down the line in the clinic. And I think things will be completely different if the sectors that contributed to these diseases were all present at the patient's appointment. I think we start to see things a little bit differently because it's invisible, right? We've done our jobs, it's done. But what if the true cost of, say, housing or these other policies take into consideration the health implications of those exposures? I think we'd start having a totally different conversation. So some of my work is starting now looking at how we can apply this health lens as a central consideration in decision making. That's not to say that health takes priority over everything else and everyone just drop everything else they do. But that actually if we can start thinking about co-benefits and mutual benefits across these different sectors, we can actually create efficiencies that both deliver what we need to do in terms of that particular sector, but also create health. Health is not created by the health sector alone. And I started realizing that actually it's not that easy, and that's maybe why nobody's doing it, and it's really complicated. But it's slow. I'm starting to understand how. Some of the work we're doing, we're about to start, is looking at how we can better understand these policy processes so we can better understand how to create these efficiencies. With the added bonus that actually having these health indicators, when we think about benefits from these urban investments, we're missing a trick here. What are the health indicators that we can add and measure that actually show the benefit that the city residents, who presumably it's for, it's not just for the amorphous city, are experiencing? So just to finish off, we started thinking about this and applying that equity lens in trying to think about these kind of interventions that are not obviously health related, but we know create health. But the important thing as we think about these interventions is firstly that we address equity, but beyond that we need to really strive so that we don't make we don't have a situation where, you know, if this is a city, where we have a city where we've got the urban parks and the bicycle lanes and the public swimming pool and the tennis courts and the... It's all happening in the city. But where is it happening? No, but you live in the same city. Just hop out of this, climb onto that, climb into this guy's back, just get a catapult and you can access it. Sure, of course. It's your same city. It's not really, is it? So it's one thing to think about these interventions, another thing to think about where and how they're distributed across the city. Otherwise, you end up in a situation where you measure health indicators and you don't find an impact because at a population level, you're not actually reaching the people who will benefit the most from it. You mustn't laugh. I'm really proud of this sketch I did yesterday. This is the cliff I was talking about. Because it's really awesome, I'm still going to walk you through it because, you know, it might just be blowing your mind right now. But this is the river. This is the cliff. This is the city. See, I put Joburg in there. Yeah. And the city, potentially, with some of those S's, is making us sicker, right? Pushing inequitably, some people more than others, over into this river, waiting for this health service. That's an ambulance. And represents clinics, to pick it up, right? So you can say, oh, we're doing a good job here. But what about this arrow in the push here? Can you imagine a situation where instead of that, we have the city making us healthier? So not only just getting rid of that arrow, but actually blocking the cliff. And I think that's how we need to start thinking about things, not just taking the arrow away, but preventing us from going over. This is a black smoke to show that the car's driving away because you don't need it anymore. And it's pushing this way. And because they're healthier, they've also got a bit more money to get some clothes. There's a data gap here. There's a lot we don't know about how to do this. And this is some of the work that we're starting to grapple with at the initiative that my research is conducted within. So this is my last slide, the last S, which is the real reason I'm having a cosmopolitan. These four women did more to mainstream sex in regular conversation than almost any health education, whatever. Not that they necessarily be doing what this one was doing. But it's important to mainstream. If you want to address something, having it behind closed doors, having it in a particular section, it doesn't work. We need to mainstream. And I can imagine a situation where we mainstream the health conversation beyond just the doctors and the epidemiologists, across all of society. See what I did there. So we have more thinking about health in the city, thinking about these faces, not just being doctors, but being across different sectors, across those different S's, which I'm going to test you on just now, and looking at how we can actually mainstream this health conversation and actually create health in our cities. I think I'll stop there.